Well, welcome everyone to the latest episode of As a Matter of Fact, an interview series powered by Nuclear Matters, which gives experts and thought leaders a forum to discuss nuclear energy's role in protecting the environment, promoting economic stability, and enhancing national security. My name is Dan Smith, and I'm the campaign manager for Nuclear Matters. I'm joined today by Dr. Rita Baranwal, the Vice President of Nuclear and Chief Nuclear Officer at the Electric Power Research Institute, also known as EPRI. Prior to joining EPRI, Dr. Baranwal most recently served as the Assistant Secretary for Nuclear Energy at DOE and has over a decade of experience in developing the next generation of nuclear energy. Rita, thank you so much for being with us today. Good morning.
Good morning. Thanks for having me, Dan.
Absolutely. Well, I want to start off with a question that takes you back maybe a little bit. What first led you to care about the climate and ultimately become a supporter of nuclear energy?
So my first job out of grad school was actually working for an organization that designs, develops, and maintains the fleet for the U.S. nuclear Navy. And so I was developing nuclear fuel, and that was really my foray into this industry. And one summer, I kind of drew the short straw and had to drive a busload of summer interns down to Newport News. And it turns out that short straw became an awesome opportunity. And I had the privilege of seeing the Ronald Reagan aircraft carrier being constructed. And I was able to stand inside where the reactor was going to be placed and realize, as I looked up several stories, that the fuel that I was working on back in Pittsburgh, the little bitty fuel, was going to power this behemoth of a ship that's going to defend our country. So the energy density is really what kind of was the tipping point for keeping me in the industry. And then you fast forward to today, I have two teenagers who I really want to inherit a world that is cleaner than it is today. And I strongly, strongly believe that nuclear energy has a major part to play in that. And so that's what keeps me in the industry.
Well, what a cool and seminal first experience for you to have, and also a great reason to want nuclear energy to be a part of decarbonization is for the future generations and to come. So thank you for sharing. Throughout your career, you've been a pioneer in nuclear power innovation, from overseeing the GAIN initiative at Idaho National Laboratory to promoting advanced technology R&D as Assistant Secretary for the Office of Nuclear Energy. What are some of the greatest developments that you've personally seen over the years?
One is the fact that the different entities that are participating in the nuclear energy space are starting to come together and collaborate to succeed. And there's an African proverb that says, if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. And we want to go far. And so these entities are coming together, collaborating, you know, forming consortiums, et cetera, to leverage the best of each entity's abilities so that they can deploy, for example, a new reactor concept. So that collaboration, I think, is fantastic to see. It's really started to come to fruition over the past 5 years, and I hope it continues. And the other piece is, you know, if you're asking about a specific kind of technology, I am really, really excited about what's happening in advanced manufacturing space. I'm a materials engineer, so I get geeked out about those kinds of things. But to be able to leverage technology that's being developed outside of our industry, bring it home to us, use it as it's appropriate, use it to develop new geometries, new materials, is very, very exciting.
Well, absolutely. And you've actually found a perfect segue here into my next question, which is, again, on the exciting innovation that we're seeing in advanced nuclear. Can you tell us a little bit about EPRI's Advanced Reactor Initiative and the strides that you and your organization are making to propel advanced nuclear forward?
Sure. And like I mentioned, you know, some of the biggest advances are being demonstrated through a collaborative consortium types of approach. EPRI also has a hand in facilitating that matchmaking process and ensuring the effective deployment of technology is really, really important. Our Advanced Reactor Initiative is a perfect example of this approach and a low-cost entry point to our collaborative model for the advanced reactor community. So back in 2015, EPRI realized the growing private sector interest in advanced nuclear energy systems and their potential value for addressing future energy needs. And so with some small seed funding from EPRI's Technology Innovation Program, a small research focus area was established, along with an external facing technology advisory group within what we call the Advanced Nuclear Technology Program. So this program introduced EPRI to the expanding stakeholder community that's made up of advanced reactor developers, of vendors, of A&E firms, of construction companies, of electric utilities, and other end users, as well as national labs, regulators, and government agencies. In addition to establishing this innovation network, we realized that this early focus on advanced reactors also established a number of successful research lines that continue to develop to this day. Some of them include the Advanced Reactor Owner-Operator Requirements Guide, an ORG, and that provides a technology and mission-inclusive framework for aligning end-user needs with emerging advanced reactor technology attributes. We also have a systems engineering-based safety and design methodology that's intended to provide safety assessment tools that are compatible with modern licensing approaches and probabilistic risk assessment practices. And then also we have strategic technology and economic assessments to inform decision-making as we move along the path to demonstration and commercial deployment. So with our increasing member interest and also the private-public investment in advanced reactor technology demonstration, we created an advanced reactor supplemental. And that was done almost 2 years ago, and that was intended to provide a low-cost entry point to our model for the advanced reactor community. Over two short years, participation in this initiative has grown to over a dozen different advanced reactor developers, vendors, utilities, and other key stakeholders. And as part of a success story, this program is now formally being pulled into our base membership, and more EPRI projects are being focused on topics that are beneficial to the advanced reactor community. So it's really exciting. We see this addition of new members to the collaborative model as a first step towards normalizing and integrating new reactor designs and missions into the EPRI family.
Thank you for your role in making that happen. I'll take a little bit of a different tack here. So in your time traveling the world, you've seen firsthand our national leadership in nuclear power and the technologies and development abroad. But can you share with us some of the most exciting innovations that you've seen in nuclear programs around the world, and give us a sense of the role that nuclear power plays in other countries?
I think some of the most exciting innovations really are that the countries that are looking to either deploy new nuclear or expand their existing nuclear fleet, they're looking at all of the options that are out there. So they're assessing from micro reactors to small modular reactors to large gigawatt scale reactors. And micro, we're talking about 20 megawatts or smaller. Small modular reactor, we're talking about 300 megawatts or smaller. And then the gigawatt reactors, the traditional reactor size that we see, pretty prevalent around the world. And what they're doing is they're assessing their needs by district or by community. And so if it's a small remote community, perhaps a micro reactor is the best tool to fit their needs and to fit that market. Or if they're wanting to be cautious about introducing nuclear into their electricity portfolio, they might start with a module or two of an SMR and then plan to expand as they start to see and realize its benefits. So the fact that they are entertaining the use of these newer advanced reactor types of technologies is really exciting. What's wonderful to see around the world is that nuclear energy does not have the stigma that we tend to see here in the United States. And so really the need for electricity, the need for clean electricity, the need for reliable, always on electricity outweighs everything else that folks may associate with nuclear power in a sort of a stigma kind of way. And the fact that some of these countries have just completed electrifying their villages, India is one of those, for example, it's really exciting that nuclear is being considered as the reliable electricity source for them.
I think a great perspective to have too, which is not only the importance of localized solutions that recognize unique power needs of certain regions, but also that you know, this carbon-free source of reliable, affordable power can really help drive communities and economies forward in a meaningful way. And if we take away some of the stigmas that you mentioned and think about just let's get down to brass tacks, what energy resource do we need here to be effective? I think the equation becomes a little bit easier. Shifting gears back to nuclear power in the United States, from your perspective, what policy changes need to happen to match the momentum that we're seeing throughout the industry as far as nuclear technology developments are concerned?
There's probably a few. There's a need for an updated policy and ongoing assessment for facilitating the efficient licensing of the new generation of reactors in the U.S. The NRC is certainly in the midst of doing this. So, you know, kudos to them for realizing that they also need to shift the way that they regulate new reactors. We also need to ensure that new policies accommodate the unique characteristics of new fuels, new operating systems, and the more efficient performance of advanced reactors. And then, of course, we need to continue the grant kind of the financial awards that we're starting to see reward early efforts to develop and license advanced reactors. And then it's, again, you know, going back to leveraging what's happening outside of our industry, NASA, the SpaceX kind of collaboration, those types of behaviors are going to be really beneficial to our industry as well. If we can move on to innovative contracting, for example, or have a incentives or milestone-based approach as we proceed through advanced reactor development, that would be fantastic as well. I know that in the US that is being explored. So again, you know, it's fantastic to see that innovative kind of process or progress. And then also to have continued venture capital engagement in the design and implementation of these new reactors is going to be game changing.
Well, I think the common theme that I'm hearing from you is the importance of investment in this innovation and recognizing the role that it can play in the future, in America's clean energy future, and also what we can do to accelerate some of the permitting and approval processes to ensure that it's ready to deploy when the time comes. I've said this to you before in separate conversations, but one of the biggest aspects of our work as Nuclear Matters is what we do with our advocates. They drive the action. They are our North Star as far as moving forward with nuclear energy policy and advocating for nuclear energy policy that will ultimately help people in a meaningful way. And so I'd just like to ask you, what is the role of everyday grassroots advocates in building America's clean energy future from your perspective?
I think advocates are absolutely essential to making nuclear part of the conversation when we talk about decarbonization goals. There's a really unique opportunity that these advocates have to shift perceptions. And it might be actually once in a lifetime. So it's about talking about nuclear energy, making the most of collaborating across nations, across continents, breaking down traditional barriers, and talking about the research and technology and what a reality it is. And then sharing their personal stories. Storytelling about why we are in this industry, I have found, is one of the most effective ways to share why nuclear energy is important. And so we talk about, you know, generally four things that one of four things resonates with folks when you talk about nuclear energy. It's that it creates really good paying jobs. It creates tax revenue for a community. It can be used to create not only electricity, but clean energy that can be used to create hydrogen, to desalinate water, to create industrial heat for a community, to be used for manufacturing processes that really require high temperature steam. And then also there's innovative R&D that's obviously going on in the industry. So there's the science and the engineering aspect of it as well. So clean energy, innovation, jobs, tax revenue, those types of things generally resonate with the public. And so I think talking about it in that sense in a positive way is really important. And the other thing is to emphasize that we are talking about nuclear as being a part of a community's energy portfolio, not the entirety a part. And I like to tell folks that there is enough pie out there for everybody, for solar, for wind, for nuclear, for hydro, for bio. And so we just want to make sure that we are part of that pie.
Couldn't agree with you more. I'd like to finish today's conversation with a prompt, if you'll go with me on this. So nuclear matters for fill in the blank.
Nuclear matters for net zero.